Good morning, everybody. So glad you're with us. We are just excited to come back and just be able to worship together. We've had some beautiful weather here in Iowa, and so thankful that we were able to just get outside this week. I'm telling you what, this whole COVID-19 isolation time, it's a lot easier when we're able to get outside and just be in God's creation. But this morning, I love when we're able to come together and just kind of reset our minds, focus on Him, make sure that we're beginning a new week with worshiping Him and setting our lives to be about Him, not about our plans or about everything else that's going on around us, just about Him. And so I'm just going to pray to open us up, and then Megan's going to lead us in some worship, and we're going to get into the Word. And so if you haven't, reach out to your friends, your family, share this with them, get them on with you. Let's join together and go after the presence of God. So, Father, we just worship You, and we give You today. Lord, we give You this new week. As we enter into this week, Lord, we want to commit to making You our priority. And so, Father, we come before You this morning, God, bringing You our praises. Lord, we love You. We worship You. We thank You, Lord. God, I thank You for all the blessings in my life and my family's lives, Lord. I thank You for all of Your provision over the families in our church, God, over the families around us, Lord. We thank You for Your presence, number one, Lord, that You love us so much, God, that You want to live in relationship with us, Your children. And so, Lord, we just come before You this morning, just recentering our hearts, inviting You, inviting Your Holy Spirit into this time, Lord. In Your heavenly name we pray. Amen.
Thank you.
burn away what's not of you, Jesus. Center our lives, center our hearts on you. Listening that really just feels like maybe God has left you, and maybe you've really just grown angry with that, or frustrated, or hurt, and He just wants you to know that He has not left you. He will never leave you. And that during this time where it can feel like you're all alone, or just be overwhelming at times, God is here. God loves you. He created you with a purpose and a plan. As I spoke on Wednesday night, He has a destiny for you. And the temptation is to feel like you're all alone and that there's no way out and that there's no light, but there is. And I just pray that God begins to reveal Himself to you right now, that He begins to speak words of life into your heart, that you begin to feel a love come over you that maybe you've never felt, a peace come over you like you've never felt. There's so many things that this world tries to tell us that is the answer, but there's no answer other than Him. He wants to be that source of strength for you. He wants to be that source of peace for you, that wisdom, that hand that's reaching out. He has a plan for each one of us. And I know it feels like, man, where is that plan in the middle of all this? But He promises to bring good from all things, even the most negative. To trust Him in the middle of this. We have to trust that He has a plan and rely on His strength and His wisdom and His power, His words in the middle of all this. In Jesus' name. Let's just get into the Word. I feel like He's laid a word on my heart to share this week and probably into next week, and just want to be able to challenge you with the same word that He's challenged me with. All right, well, I have been praying the last couple weeks about a message that He's been laying on my heart, and I kind of spoke on it Wednesday night a little bit about, and it kind of, well, it just kind of came up when I was reading Nehemiah, thinking about the story of Nehemiah, and then I got back into an old sermon by David Wilkerson called A Call to Anguish. And if you haven't heard that message, look it up. If you just put call to anguish, it'll probably come up without even putting in David Wilkerson. But it is an unbelievably challenging and convicting message with just the power of God all over it. And so I just began, as He began kind of rolling these things over, I just was asking, Lord, what do You want us to get out of this? What do You want specifically for us right now in the middle of this? I've spoken on Nehemiah before. I've spoken on the call to anguish. What are You wanting us for us right now during this time? And He really began to just pour in this message. And I don't think we're going to get finished today. We're going to probably break this down over this week and next week. And but what I titled it was is, as a body, is we want to go from being an armchair quarterback to a frontline general. And I want to talk about what that means in the body of Christ. And so during a time where it is so easy, it seems, to get caught up in just really a ton of criticism against our leaders, our government, our authorities, a ton of judgment, complaining, negativity. I want us to be able to talk about the difference between an armchair quarterback, which I believe is someone who falls into that trap, what the devil wants us to be, an armchair quarterback, and becoming a frontline general, what our Heavenly Father has called us to be. And so this is such a crazy time, and the temptation is to become that, really that soap opera expert in this time. We become that soap opera expert, and what I mean by that is a fake expert, someone who plays a soap opera doctor or a soap opera a scientist who really has no training. And we become that soap opera expert on how to govern a town and how to govern a city and how to lead an organization and how to pastor a church and how to be the president of the United States. And we just begin to become the viral scientific expert, the medical field expert, the government expert. Mm-hmm. And really any other job any of our authority or our leaders occupy, we as the church fall into the temptation is to fall into becoming that fake expert on it. And we begin to criticize, we begin to judge, and we begin to complain. And really it just begins to be this negativity that is just surrounding us. And we really get caught up, and I've fallen into this also. We get caught up in sitting around bashing and condemning and correcting and judging. Or if we're in the church, I really begin to feel like what we'll do is we'll label it something else to make it right. We'll label it holding someone accountable, when that's not what that means at all. And so what I want to talk about today is that if we are truly, as a church, so concerned about the state of our world, the state of our country, our states, our cities, our families, if we're, as a church, so concerned with this virus and what's happening around it, the people that are losing their lives to the virus or struggling with the virus, or the people losing their occupations and livelihoods because of the virus. If we are, as a church, so concerned with the government taking our freedoms, what I want to be challenged with, and I have been over the last few weeks, is how much time are we spending on our knees for those very same leaders we're criticizing? How much time are we spending on our knees for those people that are struggling with the virus? How much time are we spending on our knees for our cities, for our frontline workers? How much does our current situation that we're in as a body weigh on our hearts? How much has it broken our hearts for others? Or as David Wilkerson puts it in that message I talked about, how much anguish is there in our hearts for what's going on in the world today? And so as I began reading the word, I want to talk about the story of Nehemiah and his desire to be a part of the solution and not just a part of the problem. Or not sit back and be that armchair quarterback that a lot of us that enjoy sports, we love being from our easy chair, our couch, sitting at home watching the game. Well, why didn't he run through that hole in that football game? Or why didn't he make this pitch? Or why did he call him to steal when he shouldn't have at this time in baseball? All these different things we sit there and say, oh, it's so easy to see from this vantage point. When yet we're not the ones carrying that weight to lead our cities, or we're not the ones carrying that weight to lead that organization or church or government. And so Nehemiah wanted to be a part of the solution, not the problem. How Nehemiah chose to lay down his freedoms and his rights, his place, to leave his home, and to begin to intercede. His heart was broken for the people of Jerusalem. And so if we understand the book of Nehemiah, it really starts after the Babylonian captivity. Some of the Jewish people were allowed to return to Jerusalem under the leadership of the king at that time, the Persian king. These people had returned, but when they had returned, Jerusalem was in, it was in disarray. It was a rubble compared to what it was. The walls were torn down. Everything had been torn down. And so they're living in this rubble. And they're in need of protection. They're living in fear because the walls, their safety wasn't there. The lack of that defense created this fear in the people. Anything could come against them at that time. And so we're going to start in Nehemiah 1, verses 2 through 6. And this is talking from first person, Nehemiah. Hanan and I, one of my brothers, came to visit me with some of the other men who had just arrived from Judah. I asked them about the Jews who had returned there from captivity and about how things were going in Jerusalem. They said to me, "Things are not going well for those who return to the province of Judah. They are in great trouble and disgrace. The wall of Jerusalem has been torn down and the gates have been destroyed by fire." When I heard this, I sat down and wept. In fact, for days I mourned, fasted, and prayed to the God of heaven. Then I said, "O Lord God of heaven, the great and awesome God who keeps his covenant of unfailing love with those who love him and obey his commands, listen to my prayer. Look down and see me praying night and day for your people Israel. I confess that we have sinned against you." And so I began to look at this story and said, "God, how does this apply to today?" And as I began studying this, this is what he very clearly showed me. And that was, number one, Nehemiah was concerned for others beyond his own situation. How do we know this? Because he began inquiring about the needs of others. He began asking how they were doing. He began to reach out. How are those people doing? His heart, number two, was broken for the world around him. Yeah. The struggles, the hardships of others broke his heart. And so number one, he was concerned and he began to reach out. What are the needs of others? He wasn't as concerned with his own or just his own place, but he looked beyond that to others. He began to inquire about those needs. And number two, when he began to hear of those needs, he began to hear of those struggles, he began to hear of those hardships, his heart was broken for the world around him. For the people that had returned to Jerusalem, his heart was broken. The struggles of others broke his heart and drove him into a place of godly anguish. And that place of godly anguish drove him to number three, and that was he hit his knees and fasted and prayed for God's intervention. And I think the key is that he wanted to be a part of the solution. He wanted to be a part of being a man of action, a child of God, the one that lives in action and not sits back and decides to criticize and judge and complain. And see what we can do as a church, and we all can do this. We can sit around and complain about what we don't have, when's it going to end, or where the virus came from, or this or that, or this or that. And we get caught up and we lose out on that opportunity to serve the kingdom of God. Nehemiah's heart was broken. It drove him to a place of anguish, which drove him to the presence of God. Mm-hmm. And he began to fast and pray. And he was praying for God's intervention. He was praying for an answer from God. He was praying for a solution from God. As we dive into this story over the next couple weeks, we're going to talk about what happens next in the story of Nehemiah. That he was willing to be a part of the solution. That he was praying for whatever God wanted, not just his own will. He was asking God what needed to happen in the city. See, our focus cannot be our own plan. It cannot be just our own needs at this time. That will create that hoarding environment in the body of Christ, where not only do we hoard material possessions or our money, but we hoard our desires and we say, "God, if this works out this way, I'm okay with it, but not if it goes this direction. I'm okay with it if it goes this direction, but not this direction. God, I trust you if it goes this direction, but not this direction. God, I want to fast and pray for your solution." Mm-hmm. I want it to drive me to godly anguish over my city, over my state, over my government, over my country, over this world, over each person struggling in their own place. Our focus cannot be our own needs. If I allow the devil to have me focused on what's taken away from me, what I can't do at this time, we are going to remain in a place of being an armchair quarterback. Mm-hmm. Because if you think about it, a fan from home that we label an armchair quarterback, they have no authority of the outcome of the game. They can't determine if someone wins or loses. They can't determine any play call. They can't determine what happens, when to call a timeout, when to go on offense, when to go on defense, when to reconstruct and rebuild. They have nothing to do with any of that. They sit behind their TV and they judge and criticize, and they become negative when the team loses when they had nothing to do with it. When we begin to fall into that temptation to remain focused on what's taken away from me, what I can't do at this time, we remain in that place of being an armchair quarterback. I don't want to be an armchair quarterback. I want to be a frontline general that God uses to determine the outcome of this battle, that God uses in the kingdom of God to be a part of the battle, to be a part of the play calling, to be a part of rebuilding, to be part of restructuring, to be a part of meeting the needs of others. But I want to challenge us between now and this next week, as we begin to dive deeper into the story of Nehemiah and what had to take place, we're going to dive into a very tough subject at this time, and that is God's view on authority in our life. Mm-hmm. As we begin to dive into these things, I'm challenging us as the body of Christ between now and then to spend time on our knees, to spend time in the presence of God, fasting and praying and going after God's will, to begin going after God's heart during this time for others, to begin asking Him, what is our role during this time? What am I supposed to be doing, God, to be a part of the solution? I believe that as a body, that if we do this, that if we go after His will, that we go after His plan, we're going to be used in a mighty, mighty way. See, I know that I can't determine how long the virus lasts. I can't determine what happens in the government or what my president decides, but I know God can. I can waste time trying to decide where this came from, how long it's going to last, or complaining about what's been taken from me, or this or that. Or I can be focused on God's solution. I can be focused on being a part of the battle, of restructuring and rebuilding. And I'm not just talking about our economy. I'm talking about our spiritual lives. See, we as a body can come out of this stronger if we rely on God's plan. We as a body can come together like what happened in the story of Nehemiah to rebuild the walls and the defenses of the church. But that starts with you and me. That starts with you and I asking God to break our hearts mm-hmm. for the world around us, to break our hearts for the needs of others, and then to begin to intercede for God's will, to begin to intercede for His solution. And I believe that that's what God wants now more than ever before for the church. That we come out of this unified, not divided. Unified, not in different pieces arguing over this and that, but unified in the will of our Heavenly Father, where we go from being armchair quarterbacks to frontline generals, because that's what He's called you and I, to be frontline generals who are leading the way from the front line, who are leading by example, who are trusting in His plan. And so I want to pray that over us now, that between now and then, we come to a place where our hearts are broken for the world around us, and we are living in the presence of the King, and we are interceding for His plan. Father, Lord, I personally just apologize. God, I'm so sorry for at times where I have become distracted, where I have just allowed the news or different things to become my focus. Or maybe, Lord, I've allowed my desires to become my focus. God, I apologize, and I'm so sorry when I become negative and I become focused on what I don't have or what I think has been taken from me. And Lord, I want to recenter my eyes on you. I want my family to be focused on you. I want the body of Christian life, the body of Christ, to be focused on you. Lord, I pray for a new awakening in the body of Christ. God, I pray that you begin to just break our hearts for the world around us, and that we are consumed with one thing, and that is your heart, God. We are consumed with one thing, and that is drawing into you, where our hearts will be broken for those around us, for the hurting, for the struggling, for the dying. God, that we will have a desire to be involved in the solution and not just the problem. And that we won't get caught up in negativity. We won't get caught up in criticism or judgment. That, Lord, we will be caught up in your plan and your plan alone. And that, God, that we as a body will come out of this time unified by your Holy Spirit. And so, Holy Spirit, we invite you into our lives. We invite you into our homes. Father, we need you. We need you now more than ever. Lord, we desire your plan. Not based on you making this all go away right now, Lord. Based on your love for us. Mm-hmm. Our love for you. Our desire is to live an intimate relationship with you. And so, Lord, I pray over the body today. Mm-hmm. I pray that you unify us in the name of Jesus. God, I pray over those struggling who are feeling alone. Lord, I pray your presence over their homes. I pray your love over their homes. I pray your words of truth over their identity, Lord. That you begin to reveal who they are in you, Lord. That you begin to open their eyes to your plan. God, I pray against the attack of the enemy that wants to divide the church, that wants to divide our families. I pray over the attack of the enemy in the name of Jesus. You have no authority over our home, Satan. In Jesus' name, we pray that. We pray victory in the name of Jesus. So, Father, we just give you our week. We give you our families. We give you our homes. We give you the body of Christ, Lord. This is for you and you alone. In your name we pray. Amen. Christian life, we love you. We thank you for continuing to join with us, worshiping, praying, for joining with us in communion this last week. Let's get into the presence of God this week, and let's intercede for his will during this time. Mm-hmm. And if we focus our hearts on that, I know that God is going to lead us through this. And I know that we're going to come out stronger and unified. And that he's going to use us to affect this world. Because right now, we are praying for a harvest of souls, a harvest of lives, like we've never seen in this generation. And to do that, we need each other. So we love you, Christian life. We thank you for joining with us. And just to remind others to get on, share this message with your friends and family. Continue to check back with us. We love you. Have a great day. Have a great week.